Everyone, and welcome to Revolution in the Air. This is our sixth part of a lecture series in partnership with the Blackstone River Valley National Historical Park. My name is Stephen Kurtz, and I'm with the Blackstone River Valley National Heritage Quarter, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you here on this a beautiful Saturday in April. This is the last of our lecture series. For those of you that have been attending all of them, it's been an exciting journey with lots of things to learn and discover. And with that, I'd like to turn today's proceedings over to Ranger Mark Mello.
Thanks, Devin. And thanks once again to the Blackstone River Valley National Heritage Corridor for co-hosting this winter lecture series with us. As Devin already said, last one today. Kind of sad, but also kind of exciting because it means that winter has passed us by, spring is now here, and summer is well on its way. So thank you all for joining us once again here today. All of the videos will be posted on our YouTube channel. I know some of you might have been looking for the last presentation, which was done by Jane Lancaster 2 weeks ago. It has not been posted on our YouTube page, but it will be soon. And hopefully both of the videos will get posted at some point this week. So be on the lookout for that. If you know anybody who missed the presentations, or if you want to watch them again, you can find them on the park's YouTube page. As always, if you have any questions or comments, leave those in the chat. Hopefully we can have a lively discussion at the end once Allison is done presenting. And without any further ado, I'm going to introduce to you our last speaker for this winter lecture series, Allison Meyette. Allison Meyette is an Americorps VISTA with the Blackstone River Valley National Historical Park, who has spent her service year stationed at Old Slater Mill in Pawtucket, Rhode Island. An emerging historian, her area of specialty is medieval Irish history, but she continues to be curious about the fascinating history of America's Northeast and the Blackstone River Valley in particular. She holds a BA in art history and European history from Wheaton College and an MA in the beginning of Irish Christianity from the University College of Cork in Ireland. Today, Allison will be discussing cotton Riverlution, the rise and the fall of the Blackstone Valley as an industrial center. So without any further ado, Allison, the room is yours.
Hey, everybody. Hope everyone can hear me okay. I just wanted to thank the Heritage Quarter once again for co-hosting this alongside the Blackstone Park. It's been a whole lot of fun being able to be partnered with you guys. It's been a good time. I also want to thank everybody for coming to my lecture today. I really appreciate you spending part of your Saturday afternoon. I know it's the day before Easter too, so thanks for that. So just give me a second to share my screen. Alrighty. So, as stated previously, the title is Cotton Riverlution, the Blackstone's Role in the Booming New England Cotton Economy. And of course, Allison Meyette, as we established. I do want to make sure that before I get into my lecture that I mention the Blackstone Valley's original inhabitants. The three indigenous groups that resided in the area of Pawtucket and the overall valley. The Old Slater Mill currently sits on land where the Nipmuc and Wampanoag were located. These two groups cohabited the entire Blackstone Valley with a third group, the Narragansetts. I think it is important to remember, especially when discussing natural phenomena like a river, how it's been affected by human activity at all stages of time and not just after colonists had arrived. As we discuss the role of the Blackstone River in New England's cotton economy this afternoon, I do ask that you think about the previous lectures you've attended in this series, if you have, and how each speaker conveyed and discussed revolution, or to think critically about what you would define revolution as. Where is the line between revolution and evolution? Consider these three questions that I have here as we talk today and explore the mighty Blackstone's relationship to industry. So the questions are, how does a revolution begin? When does a revolution end? How do we define the boundaries of innovation and progress? And what does it mean socially and to the environment that the Blackstone is cleaner? Are we erasing history? I have here a pretty simplified map of the valley, but it does convey the immense size and landscape overall of the area. The river has its headwaters here in Worcester, Massachusetts, and runs 48 miles south to the Pawtucket Falls, Pawtucket, Rhode Island, right about here. It's also where Slater Mill is located. This fresh water mixes with the seawater below the falls, creating a brackish flow out to the Narragansett Bay in the form of the Seekonk River. The river itself is fast and steep, leading to needing a staircase of mill ponds that were built during the rise of the textile industry to slow the flow to a usable speed for water power, which, as we know, at this time, kind of the Blackstone River's main use. Now, pre-industrial textile making was a long and laborious process from growing and obtaining your plants. In the Northeast, this is generally flax. Cotton, of course, grows a lot better in the South. You're going to prepare the fibers for spinning. Then you're going to weave them into a sheet of cloth. And finally, sew clothes out of the hard work that you've already done. Generally, textile making was performed by the women of the family, one of their many household duties. When it comes to the cotton industry, we also cannot ignore the fact that the success of the cotton industry was built on the backs of slaves who performed the first half of the arduous work, which is, of course, picking cotton from the fields in the South. Now, through the industrial period, cotton production pretty much stays the same. The major differences are that instead of human hands physically performing the work, these same hands guide water-powered machinery that can prep, card, spin, and weave cotton at a rapidly increased speed. You can also make a lot more rather than a relatively small amount for your household. By this point, the increasing need for human labor to attend, watch, and repair machinery leads to the establishment of a family-based employment scheme called the Rhode Island System of Manufacturing, which has the parents, the children, and sometimes the grandparents involved in the mill employment. But I do want to start, I guess, where everything began. You have likely heard the name Samuel Slater before in the context of the Industrial Revolution and the growth of the mills here in New England. Samuel Slater was a British mill apprentice, spending years in Jedediah Strutt's mill, learning the ins and outs of every machine in the textile production process there in England. As a young man, determined to make his fortune, of course, he snuck onto a ship headed for New York, which at the time was very illegal, and landed in America, a traitor to his homeland. At the time, Britain had laws in place that prohibited spreading knowledge of industrial processes in order to keep its colonies dependent on their textiles. So employees aren't exactly allowed to switch mills, let alone switching countries. When Slater landed here in 1790, he caught word that the Providence abolitionist John Brown was making attempts to industrialize the area without really any success, not knowing about industrial processes. Slater, of course, contacted Brown, and the two ended up forming a partnership alongside Brown's son-in-law, William Olney. And that led to the establishment of the Old Slater Mill in 1793, which is America's first successful water-powered cotton thread spinning mill. Here we have our first checkpoint. Is this the start of a revolution? Is bringing new technologies to a place immediately defining the act as revolutionary? I don't know. After the initial setup of Slater Mill, textile production along the Blackstone took off. Brown and Olney become trainers of future manufacturers. Former employees began starting mills of their own, and increasing population growth are all contributing factors to this. The environment of Rhode Island in particular, physically and socially, was favorable towards the new industry. Of course, noting especially the cheap water power and the relative location of the mills to the seaboard for imports and exports. It's a lot easier. Now, textile production hit its peak around the 1820s till about the 1860s. In 1840, no less than 94 cotton mills, 22 woolen mills, and 34 machine shops or ironworks were directly powered by the Blackstone River. That's incredible to me, how just water can run all of these intense shops and places. As you can see here on my map too, every orange building along the river, my bad, go back. I'm sorry. We are advancing too quickly. I was trying to zoom in. Now we're all set. As you can see on my map, all these little orange buildings are the site of a mill. If you've been in the Blackstone Valley Visitor Center across the street from Slater Mill, Pawtucket, you will recognize this map, very large on the floor there. But it's crazy. The amount of mills, just unbelievable to me. The industrial progress taking place through the 19th century also highly impacted business strategy and operations. The early half of the century, business on the majority carried a sort of mom and pop shop connotation. Goods were financed, produced, and distributed by either one person or a small partnership like Almy, Brown, and Slater. Post 1850, the institutions were now what we would now imagine as big business, kind of began to show up. Huge amounts of capital are needed for those versus the personal wealth of an individual running a business earlier on. And the concept of shareholders becomes more common. Adding more people to management spreads the ownership so thin that the business basically becomes immortal. There's always going to be another person who can take control. And that's a very different way of running business compared to sort of as the owner happened to pass away or go out of business, that was it. This is a new adjustment to make, not only in industry, but also in management operations. I also want to discuss the Blackstone Canal, as this is a good illustration of the nature of big business and industry. The first attempts at navigation from Narragansett Bay were performed by John Brown, a guy from Providence, in 1796, merely a few years after the foundation of Slater Mill. The Blackstone Canal Company was not chartered until March of 1823, when Massachusetts legislature finally approved, followed by Rhode Island's approval in June of that year. The canal itself opened on July 1st, 1828, celebrating with a one-day round trip of the boat Lady Carrington and a whole lot of fanfare, naturally. I pose this question once again, we reached our second checkpoint. Is this a revolution? Is this new type of water travel revolutionary? Is this an extension or a new stage of the after effects of Slater's actions? Or is canal travel a revolution all on its own? Is this an evolution of the beginning of the cotton economy? Unfortunately, as soon as the Blackstone Canal hit its peak, it simultaneously hit its downfall. It was surely a convenient way to get stock from Providence to Worcester, but in general, the canal was never particularly valuable, I guess, stock market-wise. Increasing mills along the river led to, of course, an increasing need for water power, which in turn leads to a decrease in water availability to fill the locks and allow boats to travel. So as I'm sure you can imagine, this caused a lot of strife between mill owners and people who needed to use the canal. Talk of a railroad began, and the canal almost immediately became obsolete. There was no really dissolution of the company, activity just sort of stopped. The charter for the Providence and Worcester Railroad was obtained in 1844, and rail cars began their journey beginning in October 1847. Now at a canal meeting in Worcester, the following toast was given. To the two unions between Worcester and Providence, The first was weak as water, the last strong as iron. I don't know if I would agree, but that was the sentiment. Now, the New England mill industry suffered incredible losses in the 1920s, around that time, when the cotton industry in the South gained traction. Save for a few mills reopening or managing to last through both world wars and Rhode Island's stronghold in the jewelry industry, industrial activity in the valley largely faded away fairly slowly. But that does that mean that the revolution is over? Despite innovations made in textile production in the 70s, 80s, like with rayon and polyester, are we still in the after effects of a revolution? Where do we define a boundary for this? Now, unfortunately, again, one surviving aspect of industrial growth along the Blackstone River is the high levels of pollution plaguing the waters. The river is currently C class, making it safe for secondary contact activities such as boating. This is an achievement worth touting, of course, since the river status in the 1880s was described like this. The water of the river is polluted and rendered exceedingly foul and offensive before it reaches the limits of the city. So we've made leaps of improvement coming from that at the very least. So we've made these incredible strides, but at what cost for the surrounding nature? Does our polluted end justify the innovative means of the mill? Depends on who you ask, I guess you would say. Actually, sorry, let me go, getting ahead of myself again. The sources of the pollution were believed to be the manufacturing houses of Pawtucket and the surrounding area at the tail end of the river. Waters of the Mashopsic River, a tributary of the Blackstone, were examined below the bleacheries and determined to be more impure than the Blackstone water between Worcester and Millbury at the headwaters. Chemicals for generally dyes were dumped into the river when no longer needed. Easy way to get rid of them, I guess, leading to a buildup of dangerous sedimentary layers that were then, and to some extent now, considered a constant source of nuisance and danger to the public health, according to our friends from the 1880s. Now, once again, pose to you these three questions and ask that you consider what a revolution really can be. What constitutes the boundaries of revolution? How can we define social, economic, and industrial progress over time? Does necessary environmental intervention affect the course of history and subsequently the memory of revolution? Take a second to kind of reflect on these. Put answers in the chat. We can discuss, of course. But I do want to thank you for your time. If you have a chance, you can check out the Blackstone River Valley Park on YouTube and our Facebook page. The other videos for this series are up there as well. If you're also curious about what I do, you can see what being an AmeriCorps VISTA is all about. I have the link to their website there, or you can check their two Instagrams, AmeriCorps or Stewards, which is technically what I'm partnered with through AmeriCorps. And if you ever want to reach out to me for whatever reason, you can check my email, allisonkmeyette@gmail.com, or follow me on Twitter, just Allison Meyette. And thank you so much.
Thanks, Allison, for that great presentation. Mark. Much appreciated. We have plenty of time for questions and comments. And so if you folks want to direct those into the chat, that would be great, and I can moderate. I guess I'll start with a question for you, Allison. So you've posed a lot of these deep, meaningful questions for us to consider here today. What is your take on it?
I knew I'd get this. So after reading about all of these events and these things and kind of thinking about it myself, I've come to the decision that, in my opinion, a revolution starts with one person, one group, you know, kind of a centralized nucleus, doing something new and noteworthy and innovative, something that hasn't been done before. But the actual revolution of it, I guess, would be what follows, like the people around them or the people in their area, kind of their immediate community, recognizing that this act is, oh, this is new, this is useful, this is going to be good for us, this is going to be bad for us. Something that I guess copycatting to some extent is, in my opinion, sort of simultaneous with revolution. So it begins with one and then comes and grows with more, if that makes sense. That's just me.
Sure. And I think that you did a good job of explaining how it's multifaceted, right? There's many parts and moving parts that come into all of that and kind of play into that. Let me see, there's a few questions here. What do you believe was the true effect of the Blackstone Canal is one question that came into the chat.
Okay. The Blackstone Canal, because of its location and its length, I guess, in a way, paved the way for the railroad, pretty much follows, not the same exact route, but the general endpoints were the same, Providence to Worcester. And it also, more so Worcester than Providence, perhaps, but opened these two places and the places along the area as, I guess, cosmopolitan places that were involved with the world around them, country around them, and kind of expands the relationship of New England to the rest of the country. So I guess the Blackstone Canal, even though it was fairly short-lived, in comparison to the railroad, sort of helped along the growth of the New England area, I would say.
Yeah. I think that you're absolutely correct with that. And I think that something that a lot of folks don't realize, we always say, you know, the Blackstone Canal was a failure for those who invested in it, right? They never got their money back. It went over budget. It never was able to recoup what those who invested in the canal put into it. But when we look at some of the investors in the canal, many of them being industrialists themselves, right? They're almost investing in a way to make it easier for them to transport goods, both raw materials in and out of the valley. So it's almost as if, like a company today, let's say, investing in infrastructure to put in high-speed internet or something like that. They're investing in it. They're never really probably going to recoup their money on that investment. But the way that it makes their business that much more efficient in the long run, it's worth the investment. And ultimately, in the end, as you point out, Allison, the railroads move in shortly thereafter. By 1834, 35, Boston to Worcester Railroad, Providence to Boston Railroad, and all that's just drawing a lot of business away from the canal proper. But it is, in many ways, kind of that first connecting point to connect Central Mass and Worcester down through Providence along Blackstone River. So I think that you're 100% correct. with that assessment.
And also remember, you know, the canal is the spark that really creates Worcester as this hub of transportation, of technology, of industry, because the canal opens up Worcester to the world market through the port in Providence, where, you know, today we always focus on Boston as being that big port city. But if you think about it, Boston, you have to go around the Cape to get anywhere. Providence has this direct outlet. So Worcester, in a fashion, becomes a port city for all of internal New England, and everything passes through there to get somewhere else. And that's both goods and services, but also ideas.
Right.
You know, you look at the abolitionist movement, the women's rights movement, the labor movement, it all converges on Worcester to go other places.
Right. Great point, Devin. Thank you. Somebody is asking in here about the possible revolutionary effects on Jefferson's embargo that he passed in the early 1800s. In 1807, the Embargo Acts, and how that may or may not have affected the burgeoning of industry in our area. I don't know if you could talk a little bit about that, Allison.
What I was going to say is what I learned from you, so I might as well let you take it, Mark.
And so it's a good question. And in many ways, my supervisor and my dearest colleague, Kevin Kleiberg, is one of the biggest proponents of the importance of Jefferson's Embargo Act in 1807, and really kind of how it dramatically began to change the landscape of the Blackstone River Valley. Although we credit Slater Mill certainly as being the birthplace of the American Industrial Revolution, there's really not a major takeoff with textile mills in the late 1790s into the early 1800s. There's a handful of them that are present across the southeastern New England area, but it really doesn't start to take hold because English products are cheaper, frankly. You can still import English products. And in many ways, we have not we've won a nominal independence from Great Britain, but we were still heavily reliant upon Great Britain for much of the products that we were using here. And post Jefferson's Embargo Act, which basically is a long buildup that leads to Jefferson placing this embargo on foreign goods, specifically targeting Great Britain. Once that happens, now it becomes much less profitable to bring in English textiles. And so now the necessity for homegrown textile mills really comes about. And so we talk about different locations in the valley, specifically ones that are part of the park, like at Blackstone River State Park in Lincoln, Rhode Island. The Kelly Mill, built in 1810, is kind of a birth. These smaller textile mills are kind of born out of this period where there is a dramatic decrease in these imported textile goods. So it makes it more necessary for people to produce those at home. And certainly that's amplified further by the War of 1812 and the subsequent effects of that. But prior in the early 1800s, prior to Jefferson's Embargo Act, prior to the War of 1812, prior to all of that, there's only a handful of textile mills in the entire United States, let alone not just in our very area. And by 1820, that's when we see this kind of revolutionary burst where there's upwards of 140 in Rhode Island alone, just a short two decades later, right? And so we see this great explosion and really explosion of new textile mills being built all across the valley. And we see that in the wake of things like Jefferson's Embargo Act, the War of 1812, and subsequently by the late 18 teens, economic really kind of takeoff that's known as the era of good feeling, where the economy is doing great. And we really start to see kind of an explosion of textile mills, very localized at that point still, to southeastern New England, Massachusetts. Then we start to see the birth of places like Lowell and Lawrence starting to come into the picture as well by the 1820s. So that is a great question, for sure. Samuel Slater came from England. Did the mill owners recruit workers from industrial England in the 19th century to work in the Pawtucket mills? If so, how did they do this?
If I'm remembering correctly, I think the majority of, at least for Pawtucket, the majority of people working in the mills were people who lived nearby. Again, at this time, Slater's early mill, there's not a lot of mills going on. There's not really a need at the very beginning for more people, besides kind of the people you have at your disposal, if you will. Later on, as the mills gain traction, of course, there's a lot of, there's various ways of immigration coming from Europe, coming from Central America later on, coming from Asia. So yes, but it wasn't till a bit later that it was necessary. I think the periods of immigration there. The English, the Irish, and the Scottish kind of Europeans were among the first groups to come. I saw there was a comment in the chat too about how the Irish helped on the canal, which is very true. Irish were a huge workforce for the canal, the Blackstone Canal, I mean. But I don't know if they directly recruited. I think it was more so there became a need. Immigrants were coming in. Immigrants saw the opportunity to for a place of employment, for a place to live in the mill, the surrounding mill villages, and it created its own need, I guess.
Yeah, great answer, Allison. Totally. At first, to your point, right? It's all pretty much just the local folk, specifically children of those living in the Pawtucket area, right, that are coming in and working in Slater's mill. And Robin made a great point in the chat too, that they weren't really seeking out English textile workers as much as Sam was seeking out people whom he trusted, specifically John, his brother, right? And John comes over bringing the new information of how a mule spinner works. And so kind of getting the latest and greatest technologies from England that way. But you're absolutely correct that by and large, this is a local population that they're drawing upon for these mills. And then we see this wave of Irish immigrants during the canal building days. And it's really not until the 1860s with the real explosion of textile mills and the shortage of labor as a result of the American Civil War that we see the French Canadians. And then later through the 19th century, other immigrant groups coming to the valley. So definitely. And somebody made point of the French Canadians in Woonsocket as well. Let's see.
My people.
I understand that there is a new Samuel Slater Museum opening in Webster. While this is slightly out of the Blackstone Canal area, are they working with NHP/NHC in developing the museum? Great question. I guess I can answer that one, Allison.
Yeah, I'm done.
They have been in contact with certain staff members here from the Park Service. We're not directly working with them, but folks on our staff have touched base with them. They have reached out to us. I'm not sure where the stance is with the Heritage Corridor, but there are park staff who have been contacted by them.
Yeah, and we've met with them as well to give some background advice on exhibits and information, but we're not working directly with them on the creation of their museum.
Very cool. Any other questions or comments here? I think I might have missed a few, so I'm just scrolling back. Did the mill technology, routines, transportation methods developed in New England migrate to the south along with the essential industries? That was a question from Beth. Very good question, Beth.
That is a good question. I would say to some extent, perhaps. Of course, this area, the Blackstone Valley area, was sort of where everything started to grow, started to flourish. And then once, again, the revolution happened and there was more and more spread throughout the country, and we had the rise of railroads and increased accessibility to different areas of the country, it's very easy for that sort of information to travel southward, which is partially why in the 1920s, things started to really take off down there, and they realized, you know, why are we shipping all this cotton up to the north and spending all this money doing that when we can just, you know, do it down here and save a lot of money. There was that. There was different ideas and constructs of labor between the north and the south, which definitely made it a little bit easier for the south to kind of gain traction quickly and become competition, I guess, for the north. Kind of a long-winded answer, but yes.
Yeah, no, good answer. Very good answer. Another person asked, can you recommend any resources on the history of the cotton industry in the area? I am based in Dublin, so online resources or books I can buy would be easier.
There's a lot. Off the top of my head, I think the Museum of Working Culture in Woonsocket focuses more on the workers and kind of French Canadians of the area, but they have a lot of information about kind of the industrial process at the time. The National Park Service websites are all really good, really informative. There's the Blackstone Valley Park one, of course. There's the Lowell Park one, L-O-W-E-L-L, Lowell. There's other, I'm blanking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You mentioned landscape of industry. So landscape of industry was a book that was put together by the Heritage Corridor many years ago, in conjunction with a lot of folks, a lot of historians, and certainly probably one of the most concise and detailed books on the specific history of the Blackstone River Valley. So that is a great, great resource. Ranger Kevin, Ranger Chuck, all the big names here in the Valley all contributed in one way or another to that book, as did many other area experts who live in the area and historians at large. So that's a great, great resource. And to Allison's point, there's many great resources. Rhode Island Historical Society has a treasure trove of information on the Industrial Revolution. We have a series of essays that were done at the creation of the park, which are not on our website at this point, but we are going to be uploading them. But more or less, they provide a great detailed account of the important locations in the valley and why these historians were basically arguing that certain sites should be included within the boundaries of the park. Another great resource. So there are many, many resources. And I see that other folks are typing stuff into the chat, too. So those are just a few, but there are many options for sure. And many of them are available readily online.
You can always email me too if you need help.
Right. Awesome. Let's see. I think that about covers the questions that I'm seeing in the chat. If I missed anything, type it in now, or forever hold your silence. Oh, somebody asked, what was the name of the book again? It is Landscape of Industry. And I believe Devin put it into the chat, correct, Devin? Is that the link that you just put in the chat? So you can purchase it. It's a little pricey, but it is worth it. It's a great resource for sure. With that being said, I'd like to thank all of you once again for joining us all 6 weeks here. And Allison, thank you for joining us today and offering this presentation. I'll be happy and to hang around after, and I'm sure Allison will be here. We can unmute ourselves and have a little more of an informal chat. I would be remiss too, though, if I did not at least mention the big news that came out this week. If you did not see, it is now official that the National Park Service has acquired the Old Slater Mill complex, so the 3.5 acres. Old Slater Mill itself, the Wilkinson Mill, and the Sylvanus Brown House. So that was extremely exciting news. I got very happy messages from Kevin back at home that was happening. So a long time coming. It has been a process, but all of us here at the park are extremely excited and extremely happy to begin this next new chapter. And once again, keep your eye on our website, our Facebook page, and all that for upcoming events. I'm sure we're going to have stuff this summer that is coming down the line as well. So be on the lookout there. And thank you, Allison. Thank you to the Heritage Corridor. Thank all of you for being with us these past few weeks, and have a wonderful weekend, everybody. And we'll see you real soon out there in the valley. Take care, everybody.
Great job, Allison.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I had ancestors who lived in Woonsocket, and I'm writing up a family history, and I'm trying to figure out how many mills there actually were in the town in the 1860s. And I don't know how to get that number. I've done a lot of research, and it looks like the whole town was covered with textile mills around then, and I'm just trying to get a number, actually.
So great question, and one of my experts on here may have an exact number, but a lot, you are correct. More or less what happens is there's several villages that kind of grow up into this really kind of just mass of industry. And in Woonsocket, the neat part was that there was that precipitous bend in the river where it almost curved. So it made it an ideal place to kind of build a power canal system, similar to what you would see up in Lowell, which was not at all the norm by and large across the valley, right? You usually just have a raceway off of the river itself going through the mill, tail race back in. But there's this power canal system that they're able to establish in Woonsocket. For an exact number of how many mills in 1860, I'm not 100% sure. Perhaps somebody on here would have an answer. I do know that the Museum of Work and Culture, if you haven't been by there, in Rhode Island Historical Society, they have a whole bunch of maps and a whole bunch of resources there. So they could probably get you an exact answer. And I could probably get you an exact answer too, just not off the top of my head. So if any of my dear friends on this call have an exact number for 1860, I would appreciate it. But
I'm really looking forward to going there. I see it just is opening up again, the museum, very soon. So that would be great to see it.
Yeah, and it, like I said, that place is just a treasure trove of not just specifically Woonsocket history, but Valley history. And I think that Allison mentioned it's very much focused on the immigrant story to the Valley too.
Right.
And if you've never been there and you're working on a project like that, I highly suggest it, and at least reaching out to the staff there. They are all great people, and they are all very knowledgeable. So that would be definitely a good place to look for that.
What were the major textile cities along the Blackstone? Was it Pawtucket, Woonsocket, Worcester, anywhere else?
So that's a great question.
Yeah,
and so there's kind of this very large conglomerate of communities being eventually separate units, but more or less the greater Providence area, Central Falls, Pawtucket, Providence proper. And then even not in the Blackstone Valley proper, but extending down into places like Warwick, for example. So there is this just huge conglomerate of industry in the greater Providence area. And Woonsocket certainly became another one of those major bases, as did Worcester. Now, in between, we very much see some powers that develop across the valley, but we have to remember the nature of industry in the valley too. So the Rhode Island system of manufacture, very much a village-based system, not the mill girls, huge boarding houses story of a place like Lowell or Lawrence, very much these very intimate, smaller scale communities where companies and individual owners are creating these villages where housing is provided, where there's the church, where there's the school. And so there's several of the, there's not just several, there's many of these that dot the river all the way up and down. Ashton, Albion, Sutton, Blackstone, there's a whole bunch of them that line Uxbridge, that line the river from Worcester down the Providence. But they're really kind of these village-based, smaller community systems that are created. Now, that's not to say that certain companies did not set up their own kind of mini empires too. So for example, the Lonsdale Company, which in Lonsdale in Lincoln in Cumberland, Rhode Island, modern Lincoln in Cumberland, Rhode Island. And this is ties into the story that we tell at Blackstone River State Park, but they established several mill villages within a 3 mile span of the river that kind of becomes their own mill empire. And the Lonsdale Company between Lonsdale proper, where they have several mills down there, including eventually by the 1880s, the Ann and Hope Mill, to the Berkeley Mills and the Ashton Mills, all of those being part of kind of this mini empire that was created, but still not so much a sprawling metropolis like we see kind of happening in places like Lowell, Lawrence, Woonsocket, Providence, but more of these isolated villages that are kind of part of this larger cotton empire. I don't know if that really did a good job of answering your question.
Definitely helpful, yeah.
And the industry that grew up around the textile mills as well. If you think of Draper and Whiting's Works.
Yep, absolutely. And that's an important part of the story to Devin's point, right? The certain companies find these niche markets like the Whiting's and the Drapers producing the machinery that is used in these textile mills. And in the end, some of those companies last longer and hold more power because cotton mills are going other places, but they hold that market of how to make a Draper loom, how to make a Northrop loom, right? And that has legs. And so even as cotton mills start to move, places like the Drapers and Whitensville, Drapers and Hopedale and Whitensville, right? They maintain their base of power slightly longer than a lot of the textile mills do because they are producing those products that are needed in the industry. And even beyond that, to Devin's point too, there are a million and one industries that eventually develop, right? It starts with cotton textiles, but there are mills producing rubber in Woonsocket. There are
wire in Worcester.
Right, exactly. The lime industry through the 19th century especially is huge down in the area of Lincoln, Rhode Island. Lime Rock being one of the oldest lime coring operations in the entire country starting in the 1600s. Roger Williams writing about it in the 1600s. And the production of lime to be used for mortar for building structures. Very important part of industry here in the valley that really profited from the Blackstone Canal and making it that much easier to take that product down to market in the Port of Providence. So many cooperating industries that really kind of move in and play an important part of the survival of industry here in the valley.
And we still have several industries still today.
Right. Exactly.
In Woonsocket alone.
Yep.
Or Riverdale Mill in Northbridge, producing, of all things, wire cages for lobster traps.
Right.
Are they still using the water power or other
energy? Riverdale Mill is using a lot of water to generate electricity for their factory.
Okay. So it's still being used. Yeah.
It is. At least with that mill.
Well, thank you. That's great to get all that information. Thanks a lot.
Anyone else have any questions, parting thoughts? If not, it is great seeing so many familiar faces. I'm going to miss seeing all of you on these Zoom calls, but hopefully as we work towards things getting back to normal, maybe we'll be able to see each other at some point over the upcoming months, for sure. I would love that. And we'll definitely keep you all updated about any other cool things that we'll be doing over the next few months. But thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a great weekend.
Bye-bye.
Take care.